morning. Welcome to worship. Hello. Can you hear me? Good. Thank you. I'll invite you. I'll take a moment. I'm just going to turn this off now.
That's a little bit there. That's maybe a little bit less of that booming voice of authority, which you all know that I have anyways. Welcome to worship today. God bless you. You've managed to find your way through the snow and the weather and made it here, following the dog packs. God bless you as we gather today. The new season of Lent begins. It has begun. Ash Wednesday this past week. Through this season, you will hear the call to consider your life. To consider your place before God. How God is calling you to be His child. Sometimes that seems like a burden, but in fact it is freedom. It is grace. It is goodness. And that is what we hope you will receive as we enter into this season of Lent. And so, begin Lent, we need to unburden ourselves before God, and so I would invite you to please rise with me and let us begin with a brief word of confession and forgiveness. The congregation, please rise. Brothers and sisters, we begin our worship as we live our lives. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, so that we might perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. The truth is not in us. But if we confess our sin, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Great promise that is ours in Jesus Christ. I invite you to take a moment in the silence of your heart to come before God in confession. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will, and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Thanks be to God, that we have been provided with a Redeemer. That we have this promise that any time we turn to God in confession, any time we unburden ourselves before God, there is release. There is forgiveness. So I invite you now to receive that forgiveness. For we know that in the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for His sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, by His authority, I therefore declare to you, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. This is good news, brothers and sisters. Let us join together. Our opening hymn declares that Jesus will be our song.
You alone are my king and our peace.
God we have on the journeys closely with us through all of our days. Brothers and sisters, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us continue to raise our hearts and our voices. Our next song, Jesus, Messiah.
Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
I invite the congregation to be seated. We turn now to our scripture readings for today.
Our first reading for this first Sunday of Lent is taken from Genesis chapter 2, verse 15 to 17, 3 verses 1 to 7. And it is written, "The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, 'You shall freely eat of every tree in the garden, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in that day that you eat of it, you shall die.' Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, 'Did God say, you shall not eat of any tree in the garden?' And the woman said to the serpent, 'We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you will die.' But the serpent said to the woman, 'You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil.' Then the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and it was a delight to the eyes, and so that the tree was said to be desired to make one wise. She took its fruit and ate. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. And the eyes of both were opened, and they knew they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is taken from St. Paul's letter to the church in Rome, chapter 5, verses 12 to 19. And the Apostle Paul writes, "Therefore, just as sin came through the world through one man, and death came through sin, and death spread to all because we have all sinned, sin was indeed in the world before the law, but sin is not reckoned where there is no law. Yet death is exercised from Adam to Moses, and over those whose sins were not like the transgression of Adam, who is a type of one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass, for if many died through one man's trespass, much more surely how the grace of God and the free gift and the grace of one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many, and the free gift is not like the effect of one man's sin. For the judgment following the trespass brought through condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brings justification. If, because of one man's trespass, death exercised dominion through that one, much more surely will those who receive the abundance of grace and free gift of righteousness exercise dominion in life through one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, just as one man's trespass led to condemnation for all, so one man's act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all. Just as if we're just as by one man's disobedience all remain sinners, but by one man's obedience many will be made righteous." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Continue to give heart and attention to God's word today. We're hearing much about temptation, falling into temptation, sin and the reality of sin and the wages of sin, and much of that coming through in our readings. Our song invites us once again to be humble before God, to consider our lives, the ways in which we have fallen short, and to be honest with God, and to know that with God there is renewal. There's promise of being lifted up once again. So wherever you may be in your own life and on reflections, may this song speak to your heart. Let us join together. Happy are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Happy are those to whom the Lord leaves no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no disease. While I kept silence, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not hide my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all who are faithful offer
else it will not stay here. Many are the torments of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds those who trust in the Lord. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all who are upright in heart. Here ends our song. Oh man. This time, anybody who wants to come and join me up here at the front, I would invite you to come on down.
gospel today is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, the 4th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. And Matthew writes, "Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, 'If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread.' But Jesus answered, 'It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God.' Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, 'If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone.' Jesus said to him, 'Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test.' Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and all their splendor. And he said to them, 'All these I will give to you if you will fall down and worship me.' Jesus said to him, 'Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him.' Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I invite the congregation to be seated. Friends in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So let me begin by asking, did everybody get a Werther's? Yeah, some of you maybe got a couple, sneaky. Still got it? Yeah. Do you enjoy Werther's? That rich, creamy, caramel flavor. Oh, it's good, isn't it? Roll it around on your tongue. Mmm. Oh, it's so flavorful, so good. I've got bags of them. Bags of them, people. Wow. One more? They're good. I made a bit of a mistake putting it in my mouth. Now I've got to have it there the rest of the sermon. How many of you have eaten yours already? Got a few of you? A few of you are holding out. Huh? Even with these people in there, you feel the urge, you feel the pull. A few of you are kind of looking at your orders. Do I go for it? Temptation. It's tough stuff, isn't it? Now, maybe Werther's isn't the greatest thing to be tempted with. Maybe you don't even care about it. Candy's not your problem. You don't have an issue with it. And I only gave you one, and you only had to last an hour. So it's not bad. But we wrestle with temptation. I do. Maybe you don't. But most of us do. There are things in this world that pull to us that we know are not in concert with what God would have us do and be. We struggle with impatience. We want what we want. We want it now, not necessarily on God's time. We struggle with self-control. We struggle with immaturity. We struggle with desire. These are the aspects of sin that are a part of our life, that we deal with each and every day as people of faith. When we give in, which we all do from time to time, it can be powerful. It can change your life. There are incredibly destructive things in this world that can come upon us very slowly, very simply. It seems like it's no big deal. It's no big deal to talk trash about somebody, or to gossip, or to flip on the internet and look at some of those websites. There's a whole scan of things that are out there that can pull us in, and can lead us down paths that are destructive, and not what God would have us be. So, thanks be to God, I say, for the season of Lent. That's probably a phrase you haven't heard a whole lot. Lent seems to be a dour time, or it's one of those times where, you know, we think of sack and ashes on our forehead, and we think of flagellating ourselves. I don't know what Lent means to you, but generally we don't think of it as something to be deeply thankful for, but it is. The church has designed it as 40 days to say, take some time to consider your life. Take a look at it with thanksgiving, but with honesty. Is there something in your life that you need to surrender to God? Consider that. And I'm going to try to give you three things that I hope maybe will guide us to enter into Lent a little bit. And I'm going to, well, we'll see if I get to three or not. again, I think I've said this before, it's in one of my sermons, and Heather often tells me afterwards, you didn't give us 3 points. You said you were going to give us 3, and you gave us 2. And that's not uncommon because I don't always follow my text. I start just preaching. But I think the first point we need to begin with to enter into Lent properly and to enter into some of that struggling with temptation is we need to fess up. Know what that term is? Fess up. Never heard that? Anybody at all know what that means? Confess. We need to honestly, truly, come to God. Here in this place, when we practice confession and absolution, take a second. Talk to God. Listen to something specifically. And outside of this place, come before God and confess, I've fallen short. God, I know that I've blown it. I know that I've fallen back into those old traps, those things that pull me away from you. Come before God, truly and honestly, and come before the cross. Because Jesus also knows what it is to be tempted. Jesus also knows the pulls of this world. I heard an old story about a group of people who were out hiking in the wilderness. They're hiking in the mountains, and as they're doing that, they came across a woodsman carrying this big old axe over his shoulder, trudging up the mountain, just climbing as hard as he could, powerfully, going up, and they said, hey, excuse me, where are you going? There's lots of trees around us here. Why are you heading up the mountain? He said, I'm preparing my cabin. And I got to get up that mountain because that's where the strongest trees are. Those are the ones that have been tested by storms and by wind and by weather and by elements and thin air and all of that. And that's where the strongest wood is. I'm heading up the mountain. And I think Jesus has gone up the mountain. He climbed Mount Calvary. And he not only found the hardest wood, he was nailed for our sake. So that we could receive his power. His strength, once we have unburdened and given ourselves over to God. So begin by fessing up. Come to the cross. Come there and say, Lord, I need that strength that only you have. And once you've done that, step up to the cross, but give up that stuff. I think, you know, what's one of the, and we all wrestle with this, one of the biggest difficulties we have is that we do come to the cross. It is a gift. It is a wonderful place of power and promise. And we lay our stuff down there, and then, you know what, as we're walking away, we kind of glance back. And we think, yeah, you know what, Jesus, you probably can't handle all of that. I better just take back a little bit more of that. Yeah, I can't quite give you all of it. We pull back some of those feelings of whatever it may be, anger, resentment, jealousy, pride, self-importance. I don't know what it is, but all these things that we want to cling to rather than just completely unburdening and giving it all over to Jesus and saying, take it. Use me. I need to be completely emptied to you. So we've got to give it up. Just give it over, and that's a daily struggle that only happens as we completely commit ourselves to coming back to Jesus every day. As I was talking about in the kids' message there, it's a discipline of daily committing ourselves to prayer, to scripture, to doing all these things. Martin Luther had a great little saying. He said, you know what, Martin Luther was one of the giants of faith, right? Everybody thought he had it all figured out, he had no problems, but he did it constantly, every day he wrestled with temptation. And he says, you know what, it's like this. The devil comes every day, and he knocks on the door of my heart. Every day with something that wants to pull me away just a little bit from God. And the devil says, who lives here? And Jesus comes to the door. And Jesus says, Martin Luther used to live here. He's moved out. This is my residence now. You're not welcome. We have to get that close to our Savior. We need to walk with him. And we do that as we share at his holy table. We do that as we pray with and for one another. We do that as we sing these songs. We do this as we go out into the world and we seek and find ways to be people of faith to those around us. And that's what I want to encourage us as we go into Lent. We need to fess up, we need to step up and give up, and then we need to brush up. As we come to the cross, Jesus will give us possibilities and promises and things that we can take up. And so I want you to really, this next week, really, I want you to go home and consider, what can you take on? What can you add into your life? And I know you're thinking, oh, really, come on. One more thing to do? Well, it's going to be a discipline. It'll be a challenge. And I will absolutely tell you that the moment you try to take something on that's going to build your faith, opposition is going to come. You're going to find all of a sudden that all kinds of things are going to come into your life that will prevent you or make it difficult to do that thing. That is the reality of the world and the reality of the powers that are at work in this world as well. And it's a certainty. but strive, continue to do that. And share with somebody else what you're going to do. Don't do it alone. That's part of our problem as people in this Canadian culture, is that we're such rugged individualists. There's strength in that, but there's also tremendous weakness in that we should always find at least one other person who will walk with us. Because Jesus says, where two or three gather in my name, I'll be there. And there will be strength to help us along that way. So consider, can you read the Bible every day? 5 minutes? Can you spend a little time in prayer if that's not something you do? Maybe those aren't things that really draw you. Maybe you can find something you can volunteer with. You can give your time, your energy to. Maybe it's a stewardship call. Maybe it's God calling you to say, I want you to grow in your giving and your ability, whether it's to this congregation or to some other thing. I don't know what it may be, but really prayerfully this next week, consider what it may be that you can use to brush up your ability and your strength to walk closely to the Savior. And that's the path that enables us to say no to temptation. And I'll give you one last image as we move away from that, because it's from a pretty wonderful, wonderful theological treatise called Calvin and Hobbes, which if you have never read, get out there. There's a massive collection of Calvin and Hobbes. A lot of you know that, right? Calvin, the little boy, and Hobbes, his little tiger. And it's wonderful stuff to read and reflect upon. It's very funny, but there's often some pretty deep things that happen in there. So in one of these Calvin and Hobbes strips, Calvin and Hobbes are sitting at the top of this great big hill covered in snow. And they're sitting there on this little wooden sled. And Calvin is saying, here we are, Hobbes, poised at the precipice of Pallbearer Peak. On this flimsy, unsteerable sled, pardon me. The mind recoils in horror to imagine this awful descent that is before us. Yes, it is a 1,000-foot vertical drop onto a boulder field lined with thorn bushes. It is a journey calculated to exceed the human capacity for blinding fear. You sense of it? So hyperbole is a big thing for Calvin. Calvin turns to Hobbes then and he says, now Hobbes, are you ready to go? And Hobbes says, I'm ready. And then in the last frame, he shows them walking away from there. There's a lot of stuff that pulls to us. We need to develop that power and that ability to say no and to walk away. And the only way that we can do that is by the power of our Savior, Jesus Christ. May this week, may this Lent, we walk closely and diligently with him. And may he empower us to say no. Amen. He has set us free, and he will set us free. As many times as we need it, that is the grace of the power of God at work in Jesus Christ. This next song declares that. Please rise with me for our hymn of the day, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone.
Thank you.
promise. God is witness that there is no power in this world that can overcome what God has done for us and will do in us. That is at the heart of our faith, and so together as a community of faith, I invite you to join your hearts and your voices and let us confess that faith. In the words of the Apostles' Creed, which, if you would like to know, is on page 65 of the Green Hymnal. We got Green Hymnals here still? If you want them. Page 65. I'm going to lead, I'm going to have it right there, ready for it. We join together, confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Aren't you glad it wasn't the Nicene Creed? Brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's take a moment and share that peace we have with each other.
What little we may have,
But what we do have is our hearts. We pray that you would move into them, make them your residence, speak clearly into them so that we might be children of God. We pray for your church throughout the world. We pray that you would raise up people of authority and wisdom and understanding who have those servant hearts and who will guide the church. For our national bishop, Susan Johnson, for our synodical bishop, Sid Haugen, for councils and committees, and all those who are given positions of leadership, help us to guide and bless your church. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we also pray for the nations of our world, your world. We pray that they would resist the tempter's call to serve their own interests. We pray that you would give grace to those in power. Even if they have abused their office, call them back once again to the path of righteousness, the path of grace and mercy, and care for those entrusted to them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we pray for our congregation. We thank you for the gift of worship, for the gift of study, for the gift of fellowship, for all the ways in which you call us together. Knit us together in the bonds of your Holy Spirit and guide us, especially this day as we commit ourselves to reflecting upon the year gone by and looking forward to a year yet to come. We pray that our trust would be in you and that you would be present among us in all of our conversations, helping us and showing us your path. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, you are a God of grace and mercy, a God of healing and strength, and we carry so many people in situations that need your touch. We want to commit them and hold them before you, and so we pray that you would hear us now as we raise them to you, both silently and aloud. Spirit, we pray and keep them before you, all those who are shut in and find it difficult to get out, especially as new weather comes in and March can be a volatile month. We pray that they would have loneliness driven away from them and that they would know they continue to be a part of this family of God. We pray for those who are celebrating new birth, new life coming in into their homes, for Mike and Doreen Jerica and their daughter Daphne, for Barb and Dan, and for all those who are connected. What a blessing and what a joy. We continue to pray. Praise you for that, for Christopher and Kara, for a great-granddaughter to the Fenners. For those who have children but who are struggling as well, we pray for Luna Weimer and her parents, Nolan and Laura, and all who know and love Luna. We pray that your hand rest upon that situation. We want to trust you with her. For the family and friends of Eugene Torgenrud, my uncle who died this past week, and we pray your grace and your comfort rest upon all those who will miss him and who treasure his life. We pray for the ministries of this church that we are connected to, for the confirmation retreat that is wrapping up in Keneseo this weekend, for campus ministry, for citywide youth, for the education of the little ones and the older ones, for all of those who want to grow in faith. We pray that you would help us to facilitate that in whatever way you know is best. We trust you, God. You have the grace and the power to help us against the tempter. Help us to rely upon you for every need. Grant our petitions as you know is right for us, for we commit them to you in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Would the congregation please rise for the great Thanksgiving? Brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord. You bid your people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast. And so we ask that you would renew our zeal in faith and life and bring us to the fullness of grace that belongs to the children of God. And so in the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, we remember that on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples to eat, saying, "Take and eat.
"This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Come, for all is ready. I invite the congregation to be seated.
Yeah.
Congregation, please rise. Now, in the body and blood of our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, strengthen us and keep us unto eternal life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you gave your Son both as a sacrifice for sin and as a model of the godly life. And so we ask that you would enable us to receive him always with thanksgiving, and to conform our lives to his through the Savior, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You had a moment during this worship service to reflect upon temptations. It's something that we all deal with. It's an old saying that I'll try to give you with a little bit. Opportunity knocks, but temptation kicks the door down. So I'm sure of that. You go from this place this week, recognize the temptations that are there to blame you, and know that you do not walk alone. You walk with the grace of God, the presence of the living Christ. May that blessing rest upon us all. May the Lord bless us and peace. May the Lord make his face to shine upon us and be gracious to us. May the Lord look upon us with favor and give us peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I would invite the congregation to be seated and ask if there are announcements to be lifted up at this time. I've been away for a couple of weeks, so I don't know what's been playing for the last couple of weeks at the Bijou here, but if you would take a moment to read through, you'll find several there, particularly as you move into Lent. There are opportunities for you to grow and be perhaps even challenged in your faith. Christ Church Anglican is hosting a Lent series on Tuesday evenings, and you'll find a list of who will be presenting on the poster board in the narthex. Campus Ministry Fundraising Supper will be coming up on March 25th. Tickets are available. Talk to Yvonne, myself, call the office, and we'll make sure tickets cost nothing. So you come, enjoy a very good meal, and if you would like to offer some gifting to campus ministry, you're more than welcome to do that. Today is our annual meeting. The weather has not cooperated very well above us. I had a number of people call this morning from the office. It's myself just saying sorry, we want to be there, but we can't. Just we're at a stage of life where this is a hazard, and so we give thanks to those who can be here today for our annual meeting, for everybody who can stay for lunch. Thank you to those who provided it, and may God bless the rest of our day together. I only have two birthdays. Scott Cross is celebrating today, and I believe Kevin is as well. So God bless them as they celebrate their birthday. And just before we wrap up with birthday song, I also want to say a word of thanksgiving to Miles. Putting on the spot very much. So Miles is going to come and accompany us for our closing again, and what a wonderful gift and a beautiful thing to see. And so, if you want to come on up and we'll sing together. Happy birthday as well. He's going to bless us with his gift as it continues to grow. And thank you, Miles, and to everyone else who has encouraged and helped him along that way as well. Now, let us celebrate with those who celebrate this week singing Happy Birthday.
Happy birthday to you.